Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to Mania a Week. This week on Mania Week, I will be covering WrestleMania 2, which took place, well, in three different cities. A really interesting and somewhat failed experiment by the World Wrestling Federation to try to capitalize on getting the most seats possible for WrestleMania, while at the same time, you know, putting off a spectacular of a show to do something that stood out and made it different from the original WrestleMania and making it equally spectacular. The idea on paper wasn't bad, starting off on the East Coast, working to the Central, and then over to the Pacific Coast, giving opportunities for us to be able to get a different perspective and different crowd reactions for different matches. The fact is, when it came right down to it, this wound up causing the WrestleMania card to be overstacked and wound it so that this match, 3 hours, 12 matches. That's pretty thick for a 3 hour event. These 12 matches, some of them were really short and less than stellar. And I think when it came to the three cities, I think New York took the shortest end of the stick on just what they got. So let me give you a rundown of WrestleMania. WrestleMania 2 started in New York City, and I believe they said this was New York City. I don't remember which arena they said it was at.
Was it Madison Square Garden again?
Was not an MSG. The first match on the card was the magnificent Don Morocco taking on Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. This match started off strong. These guys had a good rivalry, and they were both strong men, and they were both trying to prove their athleticism. What was weird was, you know, as WWF was known to put like a little interview box down in the corner, show like a pre-match wrestling sometimes during the matches. In this particular case, they couldn't seem to get the pre-match box up, and for whatever reason, they just let the voiceover of the two wrestlers talking about the match that they're currently having go on over top the matchup itself. That really kind of takes you away from the match. The match itself wasn't very long and ended rather suddenly in a double countout when the wrestlers were brawling on the outside. This initiated something that I didn't think I would have heard out of a 1986 crowd, but it was New York, a bullshit chant. And boy, was it loud. And you can't really blame them, because obviously the fans were really into this match. This was a match they wanted to see, and it really just failed on delivery, and not a stellar start to supposed to be your grandest stage, your biggest event of the year, WrestleMania. This was supposed to be their big thing. This matchup ended in a double countout, and not only that, but there was a real problem with the microphones in New York City. I don't know if just Howard Finkel was just straight up drunk or stoned that night. I don't know. I love Howard Finkel. The Fink is awesome. I've gone and tried to emulate him when I do voice announcements and match announcements. But my God, he was off kilter. He could not, you know, just, I don't know if there was a microphone problem or if it was him himself, but all the announcements for winners were late. And his announcement for about the ending of that matchup came out, you could hear it over top Mr. T's interview about having to face Roddy Piper in a boxing match later in the evening. Before this matchup, Piper had also interviewed, and Piper rambled as only Piper can, and it was very entertaining. Your next match was an Intercontinental Championship match, Macho Man Randy Savage with Miss Elizabeth defending the Intercontinental Championship against George the Animal Steel. This match would also eventually lead to George Steele being in Ricky Steamboat's corner the following year, when Ricky Steamboat challenged Macho Man for the Intercontinental Championship. This matchup ended in a cheap pinfall where Randy Savage put his feet up on the ropes and held George down. Alright, match. George Steele is a limited wrestler. He's a good brawler. Macho did a lot of jumping out of the ring and avoiding him early on. That's a very common Macho Man tactic. Overall, this was a very average match for them, and it helped redeem the first match a little bit. Oh yeah, the last match's grade was a D. I forgot to mention that. Your next match on the card was a surprisingly good match. Jake the Snake Roberts versus a wrestler I never heard of before, George Wells. George Wells really impressed me with his skill. He was fast. he was able to, the man was like a 280-pound man, 260-pound man, and he was doing head scissor takeovers and was really just an impressive fast in-ring guy, as someone who I guess who had been part of the Canadian Football League and had come up when Vince McMahon had bought out the Calgary Stampede and had brought a lot of the Calgary wrestlers up to the WWF. Jake Roberts and him pulled off a great match for us. Jake Roberts in the end hit with the DDT and pulled out Damian and wrapped him around the guy's neck and rolled over. I often wondered if the ASPCA or any of them ever bitched about how Jake and the wrestlers handled the snake, because that poor snake, he just kind of got rolled over on top of. I mean, he didn't seem to be hurt or anything, but they really didn't treat that animal with much care. Final score for this match is a C+. I think that it was above average, and for being an established star and legend in this day and age versus someone who, for me, is a virtual unknown, goes to show you that you never know what you might get out of a superstar. Final match in New York City was the boxing match between Rowdy Roddy Piper and Mr. T. This definitely was, I think the first round was more a realistic boxing match. They punched at each other. Second round was second and third rounds were definitely more worked, with Piper obviously, knocking down Mr. T, and then the following round, Mr. T kind of taking it to Piper. And in the end, Piper lost his cool, threw his stool in at Mr. T. And then as soon as the bell rang, he was like, wound up throwing the referee down and then body slamming Mr. T. Piper gets disqualified. There was a brawl after the matchup. For everything that was hyped into it, this match was decent, but there could have been more. But again, Mr. T is a very limited performer, even as a boxer. And it's fair to say that I think New York definitely got the short end of the stick out of all this one. This match is a C+. It's hard for me to rate it because I don't watch boxing on a regular basis, but I have seen some very good heavyweight and lightweight championship boxing matches, and this one just doesn't compare. It doesn't meet up to the standards that a good technical boxing match actually has. This one should have just been a down and dirty brawl. If this had been a street fight, this match probably would have been 10 times better. Or if they actually just let him legitimately just shoot and fight with each other. Of course, then Piper probably would have killed Mr. T. So, we moved on to Chicago. Ladies title match, Fabulous Moolah defending against Velvet McIntyre. One of the things I noticed about this, and I also noticed early on at WrestleMania 1, was this was kind of weird. It's always a little weird for me because we've gotten used to where in Divas and women's matches, they don't announce the weight of the woman. These women were still wrestlers, and they had weight announcements at like 145 pounds, 160 pounds, what have you. These women were wrestlers, and sometimes, while I know it's rude to talk, supposedly to talk about a woman's weight and other stuff like that, I think there is a certain amount of, I can actually agree with actually having the weight announced. Why not? What are the divas afraid of? Are they afraid that they're 1 pound too heavy? Oh! This match was very, very short. The Chicago crowd also was not happy with this one. Velvet McIntyre took a header off the top rope trying to do a crossbody. The way she hit the ground, I think her boob started to pop out. And because she couldn't get her boob back in time, basically Moolah pinned her to cover up so that she could get her boob back in place. So, winner by boob slip, the Fabulous Moolah. This match was a D. This match was, I've seen current era Divas matches that were better than this. That's just sad considering that this was one of the heydays of women's wrestling when women were legitimately tough. So, it's real sad, honestly. We had a flag match between Nikolai Volkoff and Corporal Kirshner. I don't know who the fuck he is either. Corporal Kirshner, to me, looked like a muscular version of Booger from Revenge of the Nerds. The fact is, this matchup was okay. I mean, you had Kirshner, who seemed to be limited on his wrestling skill. It was mostly kicks, punches, and clotheslines. And you had Nikolai Volkoff doing his best to show off his athleticism, despite being a 313-pound man and really not being the most muscular-bound man, but he is a former Olympian, so that gives him something in that manner. I gave this match a C. In the end, Corporal Kirshner won by, well, cheating, because the referee was out of position. The referee got knocked down. Freddie Blassie went to throw the cane into his man, and Corporal Kirshner caught it, cracked Nikolai over the head, 1, 2, 3, and the red, white, and blue gets waved by cheating. Because we can't beat Russia without cheating. That's just a fact, and you know it. Russia forever! That was a terrible accent. I will never attempt it again. We had the main event for Chicago before the other matchup that was scheduled in Chicago, which was the 20-man battle royal with pro wrestlers and NFL stars. And this one, you know, no big surprise. Andre the Giant won this matchup. The star for the NFL guys was the Refrigerator Perry, who, you know, was eliminating a lot of people, was being really, really strong. And he was the one who actually got a little bit of an angle, being able to do the handshake over the rope and yanking Big John Studd out of the ring. In the end, it came down to Andre and Brett, and Brett did his best, of course, to sell for Andre like all it's worth and getting thrown right over the top rope. Andre winning his second WrestleMania matchup, and of course, one of many, many, many battle royals for him. Like Andre said in The Princess Bride, I haven't had to fight just one person in so long. I'm not going to even attempt to try to imitate Andre at this moment. Don't ask. Final score for the Battle Royal, I gave it a B. I think that they came out and gave you a very solid Battle Royal. For the football players really having absolutely no wrestling skill whatsoever, the match did not totally suck, which is nice to see when you have celebrities and people from other sports and other locales coming in. It can usually look very awkward and very stupid in the ring, and they did very well. The wrestlers did very well to make them look as good as possible. Unlike, say, Dennis Rodman. God, I don't even want to think about the Rodman matches from WCW. The last match at Chicago was the Tag Team Championship match. You had the Dream Team of Greg the Hammer Valentine and Brutus Beefcake defending the WWF Tag Team Championships against the British Bulldogs. This match was the match that stole the show for the night, if you ask me. These two teams put on an excellent tag match. It showed some great tag team strategy, and you could see a lot of what Chris Benoit was emulating when you watch the Dynamite Kid. You can really see where Benoit got some of where he came from watching him. So Dynamite and Bulldog really went all out, gave it a great match. Hammer did his part. Brutus was probably the weakest of the four in there, but that doesn't necessarily mean he didn't do well. He certainly was carried through with the Bulldogs, and the match ended with a brutal shot where Davey Boy rammed the Greg Valentine. Sorry, I keep wanting to say Jim Neidhart. Rammed Greg Valentine head first right into Dynamite's head, knocking him flat and just leaving him laying down on the outside, and then he pinned Craig Valentine. So he laid out his own tag partner to win the tag team championships. This matchup I gave an A-. I think for this era and for everything they put into it, these guys really put on an excellent matchup and really brought home the closing of the stuff that was seen in Chicago live. They really brought it home for them, and I think that the Chicago crowd appreciated that, especially with the shitty start to their event. And New York is probably going, fuck Chicago at this point. And we moved on to Los Angeles. Ricky Steamboat taking on Hercules Hernandez. This matchup was also a surprisingly good matchup. Of course, we all know Ricky the Dragon Steamboat is an amazing in-ring competitor. Always quality matches. But Hercules Hernandez is usually very lumbering and very bad. But this is when he was young and he was able to move. He controlled power. The match was very smooth. And both of them put on an excellent performance. I gave this match a B-. I think they really gave something to start LA out well. Considering the fact that the LA crowd had several empty seats, like at least good 40, 50 empty seats when the show first started. I don't know if people had all run to the bathroom real quick because they've been sitting watching movies in LA for the last 2 hours. And I say movies because that's actually how you watch the rest of WrestleMania, was sitting there for 2/3 of the show staring at a screen. Ah. You know, in this day and age, that's the reason why this wouldn't work, experiment-wise. Because, you know, with WrestleMania ringside tickets and stuff starting at like $500, $600, there's no way in hell anyone's gonna want to sit for only get four matches and then be stuck watching the rest on a screen. You had the next match was adorable Adrian Adonis taking on Uncle Elmer. The battle, I call this match the Battle of the Fat Asses because, well, they were both really large men, and Adrian Adonis, you know, it was designed to be, he was the precursor to what Goldust eventually was, and I don't know, his makeup was really fucked up that night. He came out and was wrestling, and they called it a dress, I call it a muumuu. It was sort of a little pink, flowery, horrible thing that no woman or man in their right mind should wear. In the end, Adrian Adonis won this matchup via pinfall over Uncle Elmer. Uncle Elmer, he's just a big haystack guy. A lot of this match was very silly, and some of the selling that that was done by Adrian Adonis when Uncle Elmer would hit him, because he was supposed to be this big, huge monster, hit him, it made Shawn Michaels' bumps versus Hulk Hogan look sober and normal and conservative in nature. That his bumps were so overdone that even Shawn Michaels went, I ain't going there. Mm-mm. No, sir. I gave this match a C-. It could have been better, but considering the talent in the ring, this was your fluff match. What are you gonna do? The next match was a tag team match. The Funk Brothers, Terry and Haas Funk, taking on the team of Tito Santana and the Junkyard Dog. Matchup was really started slowly. Terry Funk, every time he took a bump, just way oversold and acted like he was drunk out of his fucking gourd. It really was distracting early on. The match didn't really pick up until towards the end when they started fighting on the outside, and JYD ECW'd Terry Funk by driving him right into the table that was sitting at ringside and the chairs and everything. That was where it picked up. In the end, the Funks actually wound up getting a cheap pinfall victory over JYD when the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart's megaphone wound up in the ring and Terry Funk used it. This matchup I gave a C+, and it only gets really gets a C+ because of the outside brawling and the solid ending. The rest of the matchup was just average to slightly below average, and I think that for WrestleMania it could have been better. Final match, Steel Cage, King Kong Bundy versus Hulk Hogan for the World Wrestling Federation Championship. They had three really long Hulk Hogan vignettes and interviews and stuff during WrestleMania for this one. And of course, you know, in the end, Hogan beat Bundy pretty much pillar to post for most of the matchup, busted him open. This was the kind of match that, with as much bleed, the fact that Bundy was the one who was busted open and he was the one who was bleeding and he was the one who was fighting from underneath for a lot, and then he beat on Hogan's injured ribs and he really tried to lay in Hogan. His offense was very, very thin, and I think for the damage that he took, he should have been able to come back and actually become WWF champion. He probably should have taken the title from Hulk Hogan, but the WWF was not ready for that to happen. They wanted Hulk Hogan and Hulkamania to keep running wild because it was drawing in the money. It's like how certain times you see and you know that somebody should beat John Cena, but it just doesn't happen. It's the same sort of situation where, honestly, Hulk Hogan and John Cena, they're cut from the same mold, and that's just the way it is. When you're the biggest babyface who is the biggest moneymaker, merchandise-wise, otherwise, taking the title off of them, most of the time is just inopportune, and there's just not much that you can do about it. Final score for this match, I gave it a B+ because King Kong Bundy moved very, very well in the match. So did Hulk Hogan. They kept it fast-paced, solid. Both men did well to sell what was going on. And I got to give a lot of credit to Bundy for just the crimson mask. For the day and age that it was in, when you had wrestlers like Ric Flair who were really pulling off some amazing cage matches in the NWA, this was about on par or above par to where they were at. And so I gotta give them their props where props is due. Final score for the great experiment known as WrestleMania 2. I'm gonna give this final event a C-, because to be honest, the real hinging point, the thing that hurt it the most, was the fact that it was held in three different cities. And when you try to give each city an equal amount of matches, you wind up fucking up by just squishing the matches and trying to squish as much in the time that you have, and you don't get a chance to really develop those good matches. And the only reason why you had a couple of gems on here is because those matches were given the most amount of time and were given the best amount of time to develop. And that's where that worked out. So as a on a scale of the WrestleManias, this one is not looking so hot. Doesn't mean it's the worst WrestleMania, but from 1 to 2, WrestleMania 1 certainly did better. I'll be back next week with WrestleMania 3. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and this Mania is over.